على محمد وآل محمد اللهم رب شهر رمضان الذي انزلت فيه القرآن وافترضت على عبادك فيه الصيام صل على محمد وآل محمد وارزقني حج بيتك الحرام في عام هذا وفي كل عام واغفرني تلك الذنوب العظام فإنه لا يغفرها غيرك يا رحمن يا علام اللهم إني أفتتح الثناء بحمدك وأنت مسدد للصواب بمنك وأيقنت إنك أنت أرحم الراحمين في موضع العفو والرحمة وأشد المعاقبين في موضع النكال والنقمة وأعظم المتجبرين في موضع الكبرياء والعظمة اللهم أذنت لي في دعائك ومسألتك فاسمع يا سميع مدحتي وأجب يا رحيم دعوتي وأقل يا غفور عثرتي فكم يا إلهي من كربة قد فرجتها وهموم قد كشفتها وعثرة قد أقلتها ورحمة قد نشرتها وحلقتي بلاء قد فككتها الحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ صاحبة ولا ولدا ولم يكن له شريك في الذل ولم يكن له شريك في المول ولم يكن له ولي من الذل وكبره تكبيرا الحمد لله بجميع محامده كلها على جميع نعمه كلها الحمد لله الذي لا مضاد له في ملكه ولا منازع له في أمره الحمد لله الذي لا شريك له في خلقه ولا شبيه له في عظمته الحمد لله الفاشي في الخلق أمره ووحده الظاهر بالكرم مجده الباسط بالجود يده الذي تنقصه خزائنه ولا يزيده كثرة العطاء إلا جودا وكرما إنه هو العزيز الوهاب اللهم إني أسألك قليل من كثير ما حاجتي بي إليه عظيمة وغناك عنه قديم وهو عندي كثير وهو عليك سهل يسير. اللهم إنك إن عفوك عن ذنبي وتجاوزك عن خطيئتي وصبحك عن ظلمي وسترك على قبيح عملي وحلمك عن كثير جرمي عندما كان من خطئي وعمدي أطمعني في أن أسألك ما لا أستوجبه منك الذي رزقتني من رحمتك وأريتني من قدرتك وعرفتني من إجابتك فصرت أدعوك آمنا وأسألك مستأنسا لا خائفا ولا وجلا مدلا عليك بما قصدت فيه إليك فإن أبطأ عني عتبت بجهلي عليك ولعل الذي أبطأ عني هو خير لي لعلمك بعاقبة الأمور فلم أر مولا كريما أصبر على عبد لئيم منك علي يا رب إنك تدعوني فأولي عنك وتتحبب إلي فتبغض إليك وتتودد إلي فلا أقبل منك كأن لي التطول عليك فلم يمنعك ذلك من الرحمة لي والإحسان إلي والتفضل علي بجودك وكرمك فارحم عبدك جاهل وجد عليه بفضل إحسانك إنك جواد كريم الحمد لله مالك الملك مجري الفلك مزخر الرياح فالق الإصباح ديان الدين رب العالمين الحمد لله على حلمه بعد علمه والحمد لله على عفوه بعد قدرته والحمد لله على طول إناته في غضبه وهو قادر على ما يريد الحمد لله خالق الخالق باسط الرزق فالق الإصباح ذو الجلال والإكرام والفضل والإنعام الذي بعد فلا يرى وقرب فشهد النجوى تبارك وتعالى الحمد لله الذي ليس له منازع يعادله ولا شبيه يشاكله ولا ظهير يعاضده قهر بعزته العزاء وتواضع لعظمته العظمى فبلغ بقدرته ما يشاء الحمد لله الذي يجيبني حين أنادي ويسر علي كل عورة وأنا أعصي ويعظم النعمة علي فلا أجازي فكم من موهبة هنية قد أعطاني وعظيمة مخوفة قد كفاني وبهجة مونقة قد أراني فأذني عليه حامدا وأذكره مسبحا الحمد لله الذي لا يهتك حجابه ولا يغلق بابه ولا يرد سائله ولا يخيب آمله الحمد لله الذي يؤمن الخائفين وينجي الصالحين ويرفع المستضعفين ويضع المستكبرين ويهلك ملوكا ويستخلف آخرين والحمد لله قاسم الجبارين مبير الظالمين مدرك الهاربين نكال الظالمين صريخ المستصرخين موضع حاجات الطالبين معتمد المؤمنين الحمد لله الذي من خشيته ترعد السماء وسكانها وترجف الأرض وأعمارها وتموج البحار ومن يسبح في غمراتها الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا إن هدانا الله الحمد لله الذي يخلق ولم يخلق ويرزق ولا يرزق ويطعم ولا يطعم ويميت الأحياء ويحيي الموتى وهو حي لا يموت بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير اللهم صل على محمد عبدك ورسولك وأمينك وصفيك وحبيبك وخيرتك من خلقك وحافظ سرك ومبلغ رسالاتك أفضل وأحسن وأجمل وأكمل وأزكى وأنمى وأطيب وأطهر وأسنى وأكثر ما صليت وباركت وترحمت وتحننت وسلمت على أحد من عبادك وأنبيائك ورسلك وصفوتك وأهل الكرامة عليك وأهل الكرامة عليك من خلقك اللهم وصل على علي نمير المؤمنين ووصي رسول رب العالمين عبدك ووليك وأخي رسولك وحجتك على خلقك وآيتك الكبرى والنبأ العظيم وصلي على الصديقة الطاهرة فاطمة سيدة نساء العالمين وصلي على صبطي الرحمن وإمامي الهدى الحسن والحسين سيدي شباب أهل الجنة وصل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والخلف الهادي المهدي حججك على عبادك وأمنائك في بلادك صلوات كثيرة دائمة اللهم وصل على ولي أمرك القائم المؤمل والعدل المنتظر وحثوا بملائكتك المقربين وأيدوا بروح القدس يا رب العالمين اللهم اجعله الداعي إلى كتابك والقائم بدينك استخلفه في الأرض كما استخلفت الذين من قبله مكن له دينه الذي ارتضيته له أبدل له من بعد خوفه أمنا يعبدك لا يشرك بك شيئا اللهم أعز وأعزز به وانصره وانتصر به وانصره نصرا عزيزا وافتح له فتحا يسيرا واجعل له من لدنك سلطانا نصيرا اللهم اظهر به دينك وسنة نبيك حتى لا يستخبي بشيء من الحق مخافة أحد من الخلق اللهم إنا نرغب إليك في دولة كريمة تعز بها الإسلام وأهله وتذل بها النفاق وأهله وتجعلنا فيها من الدعاة إلى طاعتك والقادة إلى سبيلك وترزقنا بها كرامة الدنيا والآخرة اللهم ما عرفتنا من الحق فحملنا وما قصرنا عنه فبلغنا اللهم المن به شعثنا واشبع به صدعنا وارزق به فتقنا وكثر به قلتنا واعزز به ذلتنا واغن به عائلنا واقض به عن مغرمنا واجبر به فقرنا وسد به خلتنا ويسر به عسرنا وبيض به وجوهنا وفك به أسرنا وانجح به طلباتنا وانجز به مواعيدنا واستجب به دعواتنا واعطنا به سؤالنا وبلغنا به من الدنيا والآخرة آمالنا واعطنا به فوق رغبتنا يا خير المسؤولين وأوسع المعطين اشفي به صدورنا واذهب به غيظ قلوبنا واهدنا به لما اختلف فيه من الحق بإذنك إنك تهدي من تشاء إلى صراط مستقيم وانصرنا به على عدوك وعدونا إلى الحق يا أمين اللهم إنا نشكو إليك فقد نبينا صلواتك عليه وآله وغيبته كثرة عدونا وقلة عددنا وشدة الفتن بنا وتظاهر الزمان علينا. فصل على محمد وآل محمد وأعنا على ذلك بفتح منك تعجلوه وبضر تكشفوه ونصر تعزوه وسلطان حق تظهروه ورحمة منك تجللنا وعافية منك تلبسنا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. صلوات.
صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم والله غفور رحيم. قل أطيعوا الله والرسول فإن تولوا فإن الله لا يحب الكافرين. إن الله اصطفى اصطفى آدم ونوحا وآل إبراهيم وآل عمران على العالمين. بعضها من بعض والله سميع عليم. إن الله اصطفى آدم إن الله اصطفى والله سميع عليم. إذ قالت امرأة عمران ربي محررا فتقبل مني إنك أنت السميع العليم. فلما وضعتها قالت رب إني وضعتها أنثى والله والله أعلم بما وضعت وليس الذكر كالأنثى وإني سميتها مريم وليس الذكر كالأنثى وإني سميتها مريم وإني أعيذها بك وذريتها فتقبلها ربها بقبول حسن وأنبتها نباتا حسنا وكفلها زكريا كلما دخل عليها زكريا المحراب وجد عندها رزقا قال يا مريم أنى لك هذا قالت هو من عند الله وكفلها زكريا كلما دخل عليها زكريا إن الله يرزق من يشاء فتقبلها ربها بقبول حسن وأنبتها نباتا حسنا وكفلها زكريا كلما دخل عليها زكريا المحراب وجد عندها رزقا قال يا مريم أنى لك هذا قالت هو من عند الله كلما دخل عليها زكريا المحراب وجد عندها رزقا قال يا مريم أنى لك هذا قالت هو هنالك دعا زكريا ربه قال رب هب لي من لدنك ذرية طيبة هنالك دعا زكريا ربه قال رب هب لي من لدنك ذرية طيبة إنك سميع الدعاء فنادته الملائكة وهو قائم يصلي في وهو قائم يصلي في المحراب أن الله يبشرك بيحيى وهو قائم يصلي في المحراب أن الله يبشرك بيحيى أن الله يبشرك بيحيى مصدقا بكلمة من الله وسيدا وحصورا ونبيا مصدقا بكلمة من الله وسيدا الصالحين قال رب أنى يكون لي غلام وقد بلغني الكبر وامرأتي عاقر قال كذلك الله يفعل ما يشاء قال رب اجعل لي قال آيتك ألا تكلم الناس ثلاثة أيام إلا رمزا قال رب اجعل لي آية قال آيتك ألا تكلم الناس ثلاثة رمزا واذكر ربك كثيرا وسبح بالعشي والإبكار صدق الله العلي العظيم.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. بسم الله الشيخ.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد. صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم لا سيما بقية الله روحي وأرواح العالمين. Respected brothers and sisters, fasting brothers and sisters, جزاكم الله خيرا. May God accept it from all of you. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. الحمد لله for the blessing to meet another divine banquet in this year, the holy month of Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it full of blessing and shower His bounty and blessing upon all of us to be able to fast as He would be pleased with us, and inshallah spend at least parts of the nights of the Ramadan inshallah for worshiping the Almighty God. MashaAllah, we listen to the Heavenly dua of dua sahib al-zaman, dua al-iftitah, with the very heartfelt voice of Haj Abu Ahmad, jazahullah khair al-jaza. And of course, the blessed ayat from Surat Ali Imran by very renowned, world-renowned reciter, Ustad Hosseini, jazahullah khair al-jaza. As I was watching and listening the recitation of Ustad Hosseini, I said, if I were there, I would definitely arrange for Ustad Hosseini to recite this ayat in some of the churches that I used to be in touch with, so that the non-Muslims, Christians also, they listen to the story, the narration of the Quran about the story of Sayyidina Maryam and Prophet Jesus alayhi salam, especially with such a mesmerizing voice. But it would be always good if we could arrange a PowerPoint translation so that the audience with non-Arabic background could relate better to the meanings of the ayat as well. Yesterday, a delegation of the renowned reciters and hufaz had a meeting with His Eminence, the leader, the supreme leader. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect him. And he said that this style of recitation of the Quran is definitely an art. And the difference between this art and other types of arts that humans have is that this is a holy art, obviously, because it's about the recitation of an art involved with the Holy Quran. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم قال الله تبارك وتعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون O you who believe, fasting is prescribed for you as it was prescribed for those before you, that you may inshallah by the end of this month and through the practice of fasting, you gain self-restraint and self-control over yourselves. This session tonight, I have 20 minutes to answer the questions more of the jurisprudence. So inshallah tonight and perhaps tomorrow night, I'll be at your service in the service of the Almighty God. Tonight, we'll be talking about the lesser jurisprudence, as I usually refer to it, al-fiqh al-asghar. And tomorrow night, about the al-fiqh al-akbar, or the greater jurisprudence with relation to the fasting of the month of Ramadan. MashaAllah, already I'm inundated with so many questions coming. Usually that's happening in the beginning of the month of Ramadan. So speaking about the jurisprudence of the month of Ramadan, I thought perhaps it's better that I quickly read as many as questions as possible, because almost all of them are mubtalabeh, and most of you and some brothers and sisters, they may need them as well. And by answering them, inshallah, we cover the time for the jurisprudence of Ramadan. So I'm just reading them chronologically as received. My daughter is only 9 years old and she's small. She gets very weak and am I able to decide for her not to fast? Now, as the guardian of your daughter, yes, you have to look after the best interests of your children, but the best interest of your children for dunya and akhirah. There is an ayah in the Quran, and I try tonight, because it's the month of Quran, whatever that I say, to back it up by the Holy Quran as well. In the ayah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the obligation of fasting, one of the rules is this very controversial, very amazing ayah, or difficult ayah to understand the meaning of it. But inshallah, I'll explain it in a very simple word. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وعلى الذين يطيقونه فدية طعام مسكين. Simple translation, inshallah, it will be like this, that for those who can fast but with great difficulty, it's kind of unbearable for them to fast, they are exempt from fasting, and in lieu of that, they have to pay the fidyah, which is less than a kilo of grains, wheat, barley, rice, or things like that. Now, this ayah applies if your daughter, your son, or even an adult, doesn't have to be, because sometimes people, they say, how can a nine-year-old girl fast? Yes, there are so many nine-year-old girls that are fasting, mashallah. And the thing is that parents try to encourage them. See, if you want to do it, you can do it, inshallah. Try to encourage your children, especially daughters who at the age of nine, they become balagha. And at night, try to give them enough nutrition, inshallah, try to make them rest more so that they can fast during the day. And still, it's not really that long days, and alhamdulillah, as we go further, days become shorter. In about a week or so, couple of weeks, less than a couple of weeks, daylight saving changes and days become shorter. It becomes easier. So put your heads into it to do it, and inshallah, you can do it. But jurisprudentially, yes, if my daughter cannot really bear it to fast, or it's too difficult, whether 9 years old or 10 years old or 50 years old, male, female, the ayah says that you are exempt. And the decision is left to individuals. And for children, parents, they can decide, inshallah, religious, pious parents, they decide whether really this is going to be like harming, hurting my daughter to fast or not, and then act accordingly. So I try to be very quick here on this. And then they have to pay the fidya. But during the short days of winter, if they could make it up, of course, they have to make it up. Remember this as well. Can I have dental work done which requires injections? Firstly, let me tell you about the rules with regards to injections. Injections normally come into two categories. Nutritionist injections, like vitamin injections, or injections that are given for the drips, or like sort of, it kind of has a like nutritionist purpose in it. It's feeding the patient. The fatwa here is different. The likes of Ayatollah Khamenei here, they say that according to obligatory precaution, this type of injections, they avoid the fasting and you should avoid them. So either the followers of Ayatollah Khamenei, when it comes to nutritionists like vitamin injections, either they, if they need it for their medical purposes, they cannot fast, or they can switch to the likes of Ayatollah Sistani, who allows that. The reason for that, again, quickly to give you a background and some educational benefit as well. See, the Quran says, وَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ. Eat and drink. What we are restricted is about eating and drinking while we are fasting. Now, the question, the discussion that our esteemed Maraj, they have, is that taking an injection, is it considered eating or drinking or not? Ayatollah Sistani says that no, it is not, because eating and drinking means the normal way of eating and drinking. Although this nutritionist injection feeds you, but still it's not considered normally as eating and drinking. But the likes of Ayatollah Khamenei, they take the precaution that still you are feeding your body somehow with nutrition. So that's why he does ihtiyat wajib. So this is with regards to injections that are having some kind of nutritions in them. But if it is anesthetics, for example, for the dental work, that was the question, has nothing to do with your fasting. If it is Botox, for example, has nothing to do with your fasting. So injections that they are not feeding the body, they don't have any nutrition, all maraje, they say no problem. And the one that has nutrition in it, I explained it to you as well. When it comes to dental work, allow me to mention this also as well. To go for the dental work during the months, days of the months of Ramadan, by default is makruh. And it's better to avoid it if possible. Why? Because it is always possible, even they do, they have that suction that it's like sucking the saliva and the blood and things like that. There is always a chance that you may swallow. And if you swallow blood, you have broken your fast with something that is haram. You see, although you were not deliberate, but still your fasting voids. And if there, you were suspecting that that can happen, there is a penalty in a more than fidya. There's a kafara for it. So either avoid and postpone your dental appointment for after the months of Ramadan, like the brother who was asking, this was about the root canal. He said that cannot have the root canal during the months of Ramadan. Definitely, if possible, postpone it to after the months of Ramadan. Otherwise, solution that I suggest is that drive out of the town, 25 kilometers away from Sydney, from the last borders of Sydney, depending on the location that you live, while you are out, and that should be done after Fajr prayer in the morning, anytime before Dhuhr prayer. Have a biscuit, something while you are outside to break your fast, and then you can come back and attend your dental appointment. Inshallah, it's clear. If I accidentally eat after fast time, do I keep my fast? Now, there are different situations to this. I'll explain it. Sometimes by after fajr, the person, like, for example, you're having your suhoor, your sahari, and it happened that your clock was slow, you didn't realize that, or the calendar that you had was wrong for whatever reason, and you thought that, oh, it's not 5:30 yet, that it's fajr time, and you kept eating until you realized that, oops, I've been eating after the fajr time. So what happens? You have lost the fasting of that day, but because you were not deliberate, there is no kafara for it, yes? But you should avoid from eating and drinking for the rest of the day. And after the month of Ramadan, you make it up and there is no kafara, nothing other than making it up. Now, another scenario is that, and this usually happens in the first days of the month of Ramadan, some people are oblivious. He says that, look, Sheikh, I'm always used to have my coffee, midday coffee, and I stepped out of my office. I went to the corner coffee shop and had my coffee and muffin and everything. And then I, oops, I was fasting. Lucky you, that's okay. It doesn't affect your fasting. The reference for that is that the Prophet says, Rufa and Ummatima, certain things, one of them is nisyan, because you are completely oblivious that you are fasting and you ate. Continue the rest of the day fasting, and your fasting is in order. Nothing has happened, even though you enjoy the coffee, even if you enjoy the lunch, no problem at all. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Could you please specify the traveling and breaking of the fast? Two different maraj have different fatwa regarding the distance or where it begins from. Example, from outskirts of my suburb or skirts of my city, as in Sydney. Now, coming back to the Quran again, inshallah, you hear the question. Basically, the question is about traveling, and I mentioned as many as scenarios that I can remember now. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, along with the same ayat in Surah Al-Baqarah, says, وَمَنْ كَانَ مَرِيضًا وَعَلَىٰ سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ. Two groups of people are exempt from fasting during the months of Ramadan, and they are not allowed to fast. Not only they should not fast, one is a traveler, another one, the person who is ill, we'll speak about that one as well, that fasting is harming or delaying their recovery. Now, speaking about travelers, man kana maridan wa ala safarin. First of all, safar and traveling from outskirts of your suburb was only the fatwa of the late Imam Khomeini, rahmatullah alayhi. Other maraj, they don't have this fatwa. So the followers of Imam Khomeini, if they want to fast, either they need to switch to another marja, one of the living maraja, Ayatollah Sistani, Ayatollah Khamenei, Ayatollah Makarem, who don't have this fatwa, Bilad al-Kabire. And therefore, as long as you are traveling within the Sydney metropolitan, you are fine, no problem with your fasting. Or if you want to stick to the fatwa of Imam Khomeini, then you have to stay in your suburb. You cannot stay out of your suburb while you are fasting during the days of the months of Ramadan. Now, another scenario, I'm working, and because of my business, I'm traveling and I'm flying frequently to Melbourne, to Brisbane or somewhere else, or driving to Canberra, for example. Under which circumstances I'm considered kathir or safar, frequent traveler, frequent flyer, that I can fast? Under the condition that you either it's your business to travel, or you are a driver or pilot or something, that at least three times a week you are going out of the city. At least three times a week you are flying, you are driving out. And this continues for 6 months. This has been your practice. Let's say you are a driver that, I don't know, you are a courier that, and constantly you are going and coming back to from Brisbane. As long as 3 days a week you are out of your hometown, you are a kathir safar, you are a frequent traveler, frequent flyer, and therefore you can pray normal and fast normal. Otherwise, if it's less than 3 days in a week, you are not kathir safar, and you cannot pray when you are traveling completely, and you cannot fast. Also, for those who are traveling, remember that the musafir is musafir and cannot fast. If you travel in the morning before noontime in such a way that at noontime you are out of the city, more than 20, 25 kilometers away. But if you go at fajr time and you come back before noontime, that's fine. Still, your fasting is in order. unless you have broken your fast, you had the option of breaking your fast when you are outside, but you chose not to. You knew that I can go to Newcastle, for example, early in the morning and come back before noontime. By all means, your fasting is in order. Or I'm going to Newcastle after the noontime. I did my Dhuhr and Asr prayer, and then I drove to Newcastle. My fasting of that day is in order. And as long as I can come back before the noontime of the next day, I can fast the next day, inshallah, as well. I hope I have covered the parts that could come to my mind. Another question, I'm just concerned about the time. Okay, this is a good question to mention. I have a baby under 1 year. A couple of ladies already have asked this question. I have a baby under 1 year. What is my obligation to fast and breastfeeding? Coming back to the ayah of the Quran, sisters, please pay attention to this. Quran says, وَمَنْ كَانَ مَرِيضًا وَعَلَىٰ سَفَرٍ. You are neither a marid, a patient, nor a traveler. So you're supposed to fast. However, because fasting is not good for your baby, you're either pregnant and a pregnant who is close to the delivery, that the baby is demanding and sucking the blood of the mother a lot. So the mother would feel too weak if she wants to fast. Yes? Or fasting may harm the baby, or she has concern that may harm the baby, or her doctor has advised her not to fast and she believes that she's scared that something may happen to my baby. You are exempt from fasting. The same for the breastfeeding ladies, that if I want to breastfeed my baby and I'm fasting, then it affects my milk. My baby doesn't get enough nutrition. Now, the situation for the breastfeeding, again, here we have different fatwa. The likes of Ayatollah Sistani, they say that if there is an alternative, like infant formula for your baby, then give the infant formula to the feed your baby with formula and you fast. This is for obligatory precaution, not as a fatwa. So the followers of Ayatollah Sistani in this scenario, either they stick to their marja and they should fast, provided that they give a formula to their babies, or they can switch to the likes of Ayatollah Khamenei and Ayatollah Makarem, who says that no, as long as you need to feed your baby, breastfeed your baby, and your baby's food depends on you, you're exempt from fasting. The only thing is that because you are not sick yourself, you didn't fast in consideration of your baby, after the months of Ramadan, whenever possible, not only you have to make up for your fasting days that you didn't fast, you have to pay a fidyeh, which is a small amount, less than a kilo of the grains. Inshallah, it is clear for whether you are following, but the followers of Ayatollah Khamenei and Ayatollah Makarem, they could fast and they should, they are exempt, the followers of Ayatollah Khamenei and Makarem exempt from fasting because of their babies. But all of them, they say that you have to give that fidyeh at the end of the month of Ramadan. Whenever my time is over, Haji Ali, let me know. Because questions, mashallah, are so many. Does an elderly person who requires medication throughout the day, insulin injection, have to fast? Again, insulin injection is not food, nutrition. Therefore, it's fine according to all maraji. Insulin infection or going for a blood test does not affect your fasting. Don't worry about that. The thing is that if you are elderly that you cannot fast, goes under that category of the ayah that I mentioned earlier. وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُطِيقُونَهُ فَدْيَةٌ. Whether you are an elderly or a young girl or an adult, that for whatever reason, the nature of their job is so tough that fasting is unbearable for them or hardly bearable, they are exempt. And they have to make it up later on if they can. Otherwise, they have to pay fidyeh, as Quran says. Does the asthma puffer, always they ask this question, what about the asthma puffer? Does it break the fast? Asthma puffer, if you are an asthma puffer user, is a powder that you just injected and spray to your lungs, not to your stomach. And therefore, Quran says, Kulu washrabu. I'm not eating and I'm not drinking. See, therefore, doesn't affect your fasting normally. Can I use eye drops, ear drops, nasal drops while fasting, whether for medication or just moisturizing dry, itchy eyes? Yes, you can. Again, remember the ayah, kulu washrabu doesn't apply here. I'm sharing with you a little bit of methodology, but don't do ijtihad. But kind of somehow you can, but don't go too far, yes? This is not considered eating and drinking. Yes, nasal drop is, there's a highly chance that it may go to your throat. If it does, make sure you speed it up, that you don't swallow it. But eardrop, eye drops, usually it's fine and doesn't affect your fasting. Another question, what is the difference between kafara and fidyeh? Fidyeh is a small amount of payment, as I said, to be precise, about 750 grams of grains, less than a kilo, for situations that there is a valid excuse. But kafara is when somebody breaks the fasting deliberately. That's why the kafara is very, very, not the amount is much. A person who deliberately, God forbid, breaks their fasting, either they have to fast for two months, that 31 days of it should be consecutive, or feed 64 people. And if they break their fast with something that was haram, God forbid, masturbation or things like that, then there is a kafarat al-jam even as well. So big difference between fidyeh and kafara. I mentioned maybe this one as well, and stop unless you allow me to continue. If I have guests on the last night of the fasting month, this is also a very common question. Somebody pops into your house in the night of Eid al-Fitr. Is the Zakat al-Fitr obligatory on me or not? If you had invited them, Maraje, usually they say that he's your guest, and part of honoring your guest, you pay for their kafara as well. Or you had a visitor, let's say, and maybe overseas visitors, that most of the time of the months of Ramadan, they were staying with you, they were your guests, their Zakat al-Fitr is also obliged on you. However, in any of the scenarios, if the person says that, look, I have paid my Zakat al-Fitr, please don't worry about it, and you know that they have paid, the obligation is lifted from you, you don't have any obligation anymore. Please, yes, yeah, better to leave it to you now for your question. Otherwise, I have a long list of questions to read. I just mentioned that, Haj Ali, yes, going for blood tests or donating blood is fine, but donating blood or taking, if they take blood in for blood tests, it's okay as long as it doesn't affect you physically too much. You know, sometimes people after that, they feel too weak to continue fasting. They may even faint. But if you know that this will not happen to you, in general, blood tests or donating blood is fine when you are fasting. It doesn't matter. Any other question? That is your question. May I just mention one thing about those who are not fit to fast, the patients, the mardad, as Quran says, when kutum ala safarin or marid, whatever I just. If you are not fit to fast, and your doctor tells you, your specialist has told you not to fast, sometimes, especially with all respect, I hear this from some ladies that are so adamant, she says that, No, I don't care, I want to fast. This is not acceptable. If fasting is not good for you and is harmful and is going to delay your recovery or is going to harm your body, harming your body is haram, and this fasting is not counted even if you do. So be careful. You don't need to be more Catholic than Pope. When the Quran says that if you are physically not fit to fast, you have no obligation to fast, and please don't force it, don't push it unnecessarily. The voice is very low, about one. There is a problem with that. There is a problem with that. I usually say that better to avoid it. Although if you don't swallow anything in, you are fine, you are safe. But if it's not necessary, don't use it. We have a hadith about that, that in the old days it was called elk. But elk was pieces of wood that they used to chew just to moisturize their mouth. Yeah. Because there's always a chance that it we may swallow, better to avoid it. Alaykum. Yes, yes. So you touch on the moon fighting issue, not moon sighting issue. First of all, Hajj, Iran, Iraq, and the Middle East, usually they start a day earlier than us, but not always. It depends. There's so much that I can really explain here. Long story short, according to it, you need to follow the marja that you follow. If you follow the likes of Ayatollah Sistani, whose fatwa is that now you need to follow your local horizon, number one. And number two, you need to see it with the naked eye. Then even in Brisbane, if they sighted the moon and it's not visible in your area, and given that the sky was clear, but no one in Sydney sighted the moon, despite the fact that the sky was clear, sighting of Brisbane is not counted for you, let alone Iran and Iraq that are too far away. Completely different horizon than us, yes. But if you follow a marja who allows, they believe in wahdat al-afaq. Yani they say that wherever in the world is sighted suffices for the rest. Sayyid al-Khuy rahmatullahi almost had this fatwa, although he was limiting it to having sharing the same night. Iran, Iraq, and Australia share the same night. Therefore, if it was sighted in Iran and Iraq, for the followers of Sayyid al-Khuy in Australia, they can also start and rely on that as well. Ayatollah Khamenei also has another fatwa, and that is that if it's sighted with the binoculars or telescope or things like that, again suffices. So see, at the end of the day, you need to follow your marja. And always, subhanAllah, for the last almost 30 years, it's mashallah 24, it's getting almost 30 years because I started this business since 1995. And every year I'm saying that, why are you fighting over something that doesn't need any fight? Simply you follow your marja, and as you in other issues, when it comes to the homes, maraja have different issues. Baba, in Kitab al-Tahara, Kitab al-Salat, from the beginning of the Risale Amaliye, you see that they have different yani fatawa, and everyone follows their marja, and they're all excused on the judgment day. All right. So the issue is not difficult if everyone follows their own marja and respect the marja of others also as well. I hope this explains such. Yeah. Alaykum salam wa rahmatullah. If you are confident, yes, yeah. Look, going for dental appointment, as I said, it's makruh, is not haram. That means the reason that is called makruh because the chance of swallowing is there. But if someone is confident and says that I'm 100% sure, especially my dental work is something minor, and I'm 100% sure that I won't swallow anything, go, that's not a problem. Although if you are confident that nothing, you would not swallow nothing, although if it happens that accidentally you swallow some water and goes down, your fasting is broken, but there is no kafare because you are confident nothing will happen. But if you are suspicious and still you go, there is a kafare on the top as well. All right. Inshallah, and you as well. Allow me to conclude with dua for the quick reappearance of Sahib al-Asr wa al-Zaman. Inshallah, Ya Rab, a quick relief this month of Ramadan for the oppressed people of Palestine, and also for the speedy and recovery of all the patients. Particularly, there is a request to pray for one brother, Brother Abdullah Rikabi. Inshallah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant him a speedy and full recovery. with salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad and recitation of Surah Al-Fatiha. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala Muhammad. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahmanir Rahim. Malik Yawmiddin. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdina as-sirata al-mustaqim. Sirata alladhina an'amta 'alayhim ghayril maghdubi 'alayhim waladdallin. Wa kullu 'amin wa antum bikhair. Inshallah, enjoy the months of Ramadan, days and the nights. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaykum jami'an. Allah jami'an.